We will continue with this very interesting procedure that Dr. Wang just showed us about the endo anchor. There are many names, right? Don't be confused. Sometimes we call endo anchor, sometimes we call helifix, sometimes we call ESA in the endo suturing aneurysm repair. We're talking about the same thing, helifix, endo anchor. Let's call it endo anchor as Dr. Wang just mentioned. Dr. Kamin will continue with this technique and share with us more about the ceiling zone concept and outcomes for ESA or endo anchor in now specific in the wide neck patient. And I think we will learn a lot from this lecture. Dr. Kamin, please.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bhupasit, for your introduction, and thank you again for Metany Company to invite me to share experience and controversial topic about the ceiling concept and outcomes of ESA in the wide aortic neck. In terms of the ESA, that means endo suture aneurysm repair. Let's start with the concept of the ceiling zone concept. Is divided into the fixation in order to prevent the distal graft migration, and the sealing concept in order to prevent a 1A endo leak. As you know that the hostile neck anatomy or definition, it means five criteria, as you can see in this slide. But today I will talk about the neck length less than 10 mm and also the wide aortic neck diameter. That means the neck diameter more than 28 mm. Let's start with the short neck. In terms of the short neck, no doubt, if the patient fit, you have to perform the open repair in this situation. However, more than 80% of our patients is an unfit patient. So the first line treatment is a fenestrated graft. But as you can see, the drawbacks is that you have to wait for the manufacturing process about 2 or 3 months. Otherwise, you can perform with the chimney procedure. However, right now, the off-the-shelf graft for the Metanic company and the other device, standard device, if it's more than 10 mm, you can perform with the standard EVA. Less than 2 mm, you have to perform the chimney procedure. But 4 to 10 mm, you can perform ESA. That means the off-the-shelf graft to solve this problem in terms of the short neck. The component of the ESA composed of the guide, applier, and also the cassette of the helifix component. For the device selection, for the tip, it depends on the diameter of the aortic stent graft. That means if the diameter of aortic stent graft 18 to 28, you can use the tip 22, but more than that, you have to choose the 28 mm. For this one, the component proximal seal and fixation bar increase the apposition between the aorta and the endograft, as you can see in this slide, and how many endo anchor you can use. If the diameter of aortic neck less than 29 mm, you can use only 4 endo anchors, but more than that, you have to use the 6 or 8 endo anchors. But this one is for prophylaxis that Dr. Wang mentioned in the short neck, but severe neck angulation or treat the 1-day endo leak, you have to apply 2 rows or 3 rows. It depends. It depends on the how soft of the 1A endo leak in that situation. This one is the short neck 4 mm. You can apply the helifix in order to treat the 1A endo leak. As you can see in this slide, and 3 years follow-up, the patient still alive without the graft migration and the 1A endo leak. As you can see in the ANCHO study, 5-year result, it show about the benefit of the endo anchor. As you can see, they use in the more than 88% of the hostile neck anatomy. That means less than 15 mm, diameter more than 28 mm, and conical and calcium or thrombus more than 50%. But in this one, you can see the result. The result is very good in terms of the freedom from 1A endolytic, almost 90%, and also the freedom from reintervention of the 1A endolytic, almost 100%, and the sac regression or stable 88%, and freedom from rupture almost 100%. The problem is that post E1 neck dilatation in a wide neck. In wide neck, that means more than 28 mm, you have to use the 32 aortic stent graft or 36 aortic stent graft. You can see that during after EVA follow up, the neck dilatation and the patient usually develop a 1A endolic in this situation. We have one case we perform in EVA in a wide neck. You can see that post-operative CT angiogram, it show the 1A endolytic, and the patient came back with the ruptured abdominal aortic aneurysm. We have to do the subtotal endograft explantation. And you can see that the post-operative CT angiogram is okay. But you have to know about this complication if you would like to perform the standard EVA in a wide neck diameter. Literature review for post-EVA neck dilatation, you can see that in the past is still a debate, but right now you can see that is no doubt in terms of the 1A endolytic for the wide neck more than 3 cm, it show more than more 1A endolytic in this stent graft in the wide neck, and also neck-related secondary intervention. So they conclude that EVA in wide neck is associated with increased neck-related adverse outcome during the follow-up at the midterm follow-up. How about the 1A evidence systematic review in large diameter? It show again that type 1A endolytic occur at a higher rate of the wide neck group compared with a normal neck. So they mentioned that okay, you can perform EVA in the wide neck, it's feasible, but it's a high risk for complications, reintervention, and mortality. So aortic neck dilatation after EVA, we need to look at both problems and solution. Our research performed by Dr. Wirapat last year about the factor related rate reintervention in PPNA treated with EVA. We enroll almost 600 cases during 10 years. As you can see that 15% after standard EVA, the patient need a rate reintervention, and also 30% from this one is from the proximal neck. It develop a 1A endolytic. What is the factor? The factor again is related to the wide neck. Neck more than 20 mm, you can see that it show significant to develop a 1A endolytic after EVA during the late follow-up. So I would like to show again about the wide neck. This case perform standard EVA 36 aortic stent graft diameter. During follow-up only 3 years, you can see that the neck dilate from 30 mm to more than 40 mm. This one we need the finestrated graft in order to extend the graft to the healthy landing zone, as you can see in this slide. So the problem, how ESA prevent the neck dilatation? How? Yes or no? So you can see in this one, endosuture, that means ESA, but during the open repair, we perform the Pauline suture. In my opinion, it's almost the same. Almost the same in order to fix the graft to the aortic wall. It's something like a Pauline suture. So that is the benefit of the endosuture to prevent the neck dilatation. And I will show you in this case, we perform the wide neck in 2013. At that time, the stent graft distal migration, but no 1A endolytic, but 7 years follow-up, the patient developed a 1A endolytic. We try to fix with the aortic cuff, But and you can see it's still one day endolith, but we use the ESA at the aortic cuff at the proximal part. It show a better result in this one, and 2 year follow-up, the patient's still okay. So I think that is a benefit to fix at the proximal neck for the ESA. How about the literature review? You can see that 1 year follow-up for the anchor cry in order to prevent of the proximal aortic neck dilatation. This one is the observational international multicenter national registry study. At that time, enrolled 257 patients and follow up 1 year. What is the result? The result showed that the neck dilatation more than 3 mm at the level 5 mm distal to the lowest renal artery observed 12.5% at 1 month after the procedure, and 8.1% between 1 month to 1 year. That is the problem of aortic neck dilatation. And neck dilatation was associated with baseline neck anatomy, baseline neck diameter, neck angulation, device oversizing, and endocarph with the suprarenal stent. But the protective factors, there were two factors. The first one, neck length, and the next one, endoanchor implantation in those cases. And also the same group study for up at 3 years. Right now, they could enroll the patient more than 1,000 patients. Divided into the two arms. Primary arm, 771 patients with ESA for treatment and prevention. And also the other arm is for revision arm treat for the 1A endolith. They focus on primary arm. Primary arm, the researcher include 72 patients with a wide infrarenal neck. That means diameter 28 to 32 mm in order to use aortic stent graft 32 and 36 mm. In this group, what is the result? The result show that in 72 patients with wide infrarenal neck, it show 3 year freedom from type 1A endolith, 98.5% at 3 years, and 100% 3 year freedom from secondary procedure to treat 1A endolith, and also 100% freedom migration and freedom from aneurysm rupture, and segregation stable at 3 year. Almost 90%. That is the benefit of the ENCORE study. Take home message in this study is show that why neck of the aorta are risk factors for failure after the EVA. With the use of the ESA, neck related complications could be reduced. But in this one, as you can see in the research methodology, it showed the limitation is a small cohort, only 72 cases, and only one arm observational study, and only 3 year follow-up in this one. So how about the future direction? The future direction, how is prevent neck dilatation or not? So we are waiting for the Hercules trial from the Metternich company compare of the EVA in the infrarenal type A with the wide proximal neck. This one is study design, the randomized control trial. The hypothesis is the ESA can be the primary treatment for the wide aortic neck or not. They plan to include 300 triple A with a wide neck in the US and in the Europe. Study started 3 months ago in May 2023. Primary completion of the study is June 2027. And study completion December 2031. So I think that this one is a very interesting research and study in order to solve the problem of the wide aortic neck. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to conclude that the preoperative assessment of the infrarenal ceiling zone, especially at the neck, is very important or crucial for selecting the optimal treatment for AAA patient. Is it essential to evaluate both endovascular and open repair options to ensure that the treatment tailored to the each patient? And also, you have to consider about the cost burden right now. It's very important in this situation, particularly in the uncertain times, not right now, but in the future. And last but not least, following the principle first, do no harm. We begin with the simple or simpler solution first, and only escalate the treatment of the complexity, if necessary, new to the challenging anatomy. Thank you for your attention. And also, I would like to invite all of you to ASVS 2024 in Thailand next year. We will have this congress in the early of December. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kamin, for a very nice presentation about this endo anchor for wide neck. Now, I think you've shown nicely about the problem with the wide neck. Has some late problems and things, and seems like we need to fix the patient later on, either open or endovascular, because of the problem with the wide neck. The question to you, maybe to Dr. Wang also, for the wide neck, what, because Hercules trial will be back like 8 years from now. Another 8 years, we will lose a lot of patients, I guess, and we will see a lot of problems. So if we have the wide neck today, what should be the choice that we choose for our patient, given that we want to prevent the future problems? Maybe start with you, Dr. Kamin, about if you have wide neck, wait for the Hercules. We don't have the result yet. What is your suggestion now for us to fix?
Dr. Wang first.
I was going to ask you that question.
So in my opinion, it depends. As I mentioned in the first slide, that it's not only the short neck, but also the wide neck as well. If the patient fit, right now, I think that the hostile neck anatomy of the triple A, if the patient fit, you have to perform the open repair first. But if the patient unfit, okay, if there any option to treat and the neck, wide neck, and also a large triple A diameter as well, only the standard, we know that more than 20 mm is not only from the literature review, but also in our experience that Dr. Willipat did the research last year about this one. We try to perform the standard EVA, and we know that if life expectancy more than 5 years or more than 10 years, we try to primarily treatment with the endo anchor first in order to prevent any complication after the EVA.
Yeah, I agree, Dr. Kamin. I think we should be completely patient-based. It depends on the fitness of the patient. And I think you have to think about both sides. If you put in just a standard large graft at the start, you have to plan for when it fails in the future. Will the patient at that time be then fit for a fenestrated chimney, or is it too late to do endo anchors then? If they're not fit, maybe this is the time now to put in the endo anchors now to prevent, you know, you won't be able to do it in the future. Whereas if it is a fit patient, then you have to consider 10 years down the track, if they have endo anchors in and they're still fit for open intervention. I don't have any personal experience, but how hard is it to explant a graft with endo anchors inside? I don't know if any of us have that experience, but it's something to think about, really forward planning 10 years down the track.